Okay, but when you're saying the gates are going to open, you're talking about the 12 that have been taken over, so to speak. Those, I'm assuming, are not going to open.
Oh, yeah, they're opening them.
They're going to be
open. And we're opening the others. The guardians are opening the others.
Okay, even though they were taken over, they're able to go in and open them.
Oh, yeah, they open them into the black hole wormhole systems.
Oh, into an, okay.
Yeah. Well, you can still use them, except, you know, it takes you into fall systems.
Right.
Yeah.
So,
and that
so
is what
there
is
has
happening
to be alternate point. Stargates that are going to be used.
Mm-hmm. And that is what we have been helping the Guardians actually bring. You have to. They need to be activated. They're very old, dormant systems, but they're rescue systems.
Okay.
And at this point, the reason why the Guardians are even speaking publicly about this information in interviews is because in, I think it was March 25th of 2007, something occurred in the solar system that just shut the program down. We are on a 200-year evac program, period. And that's it. The gates are closing permanently. The gates are closing in this galaxy permanently in 200 years.
When you say something happened in the galaxy, can you explain a little more?
I'll get to that.
Okay.
Yeah,
okay, well,
some other diagrams for that one. Yeah. This is looking at one of those core flows, you know, just its structure, and there's like a pillar, a chamber inside of this. There's Merkaba fields that activate, which we'll deal with later if you want to see some of those pictures. Mm-hmm. But this is one of the Navajo core flow gates. Now, the other ones that aren't shown on here that look like the lotus petals, they're usually the flows that when a stellar activation cycle happens, they're usually the only ones that open because they will take you to the next density level up or even two densities up. They'll give you vertical ascension, mm-hmm. but not diagonal or going back in and back out again. They're very limited, actually, in their capacity, but you can still ascend through them. When the planet, and the only time they open these, is if they are seeding a new race on the planet or if they are evacuating a race on the planet. And these core gates are opening on the planet because this is an evacuation. We have a 200-year warning because something happened with the sun that is... it's not going to be, one is not going to be able to live on this planet by about 2976. And it's going to be before that, actually, but that's when it explodes from what they said. We're in a timeline and we're stuck in a timeline. Voyager's mentioned it, that if we didn't make certain changes in with the stellar activation cycle and reach a certain level, we were going to get dragged into a probability alignment in which the planet literally exploded because of the mechanics that were occurring with the Zetas and different, intruder races. And that is a probability line we got stuck in. And that's why we're on, we are on an evac order, and that's why we're speaking about it publicly. There are things we can do. It's not like, the world is ending. No. In fact, this is really good, because what could have happened in 2012 isn't going to. But there are certain ones that really want these things to happen, and I will talk about those a little bit in a little while. But this is the core gate structure. And it's, it's very detailed. I just really put these up not to read every little thing to you, to let you know and to let the public know that they are there and the sophistication of this material. This is why, talk about me, I'm not important. What's important is look at this material. It blows my mind.
Yeah.
I look, and the breadth of it. I mean, it covers everything from stargates to biology to, cosmic structure to pre-particle physics. I mean, it's an amazing body of material. If this wasn't serious, they wouldn't be giving us this information. So, anyway, that's the core gate structure, and they are activating the core gates. If you want to see how a core gate would sit on a planet to get an idea, this gives you an idea. That's just like a landscape painting behind it. It's actually a mural that I did on my wall in the house in Arizona we lived in. But it shows, right, here's the sky, and here's, like, the land, and here's, like, the subterranean levels below the land, and going down to the core. It shows how these gate flows work when they're open. And there would be 12 of these on the planet. And when you would pass into, you wouldn't see this thing standing in the air. There would be a certain field, and only if your DNA was keyed to it would you even know it was there. If your DNA was not activated to be in a co-resonant energy form with that structure, you'd walk right through it, past it, not even know it was there, and you'd still be in the same place. But if you have certain things activated in the body, in the DNA template, in the light body, in the spirit body structure, etc., in your anatomy, you would be able to see it,
mm-hmm.
and you would know where to stand in it, and you would know what to do and how to breathe, and you could use it and go in ascension.
Okay, so the 12 stargates that we're talking about, which have been interfered with, let's say, they're located at certain places on the planet,
yep.
physical places.
Yep. Yeah, okay. The outer ones are the ones that fell. The core ones won't fall.
The core
fall.
Ones won't fall. No, okay, so fall and those are the ones that are, you say, ancient, that yeah. are being reactivated, as yeah. you call it. Okay, and those are also located at certain
yes.
places.
And in different places.
Different places.
Yep, the mm-hmm. outer ones surface at one, yeah, in one set of 12 places.
So there will be a lot of misdirects, I'm thinking. And there are a lot of misdirects going on the planet right now to where certain people are directing people to focus on certain areas of the planet mm-hmm. which contain these stargates, thinking that they are, you know, ascension stargates, when in fact they are taking them to another place.
Yes.
That's not so good.
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah. What they are being guided to fall stargates. So they're not called stargates, they're called wormholes. And wormholes okay. lead to black hole systems that are finite life systems. And right now, they are feeding on our living system and killing it, basically. Mm-hmm. And that is why the intervention is happening. That is why the Navajo core gates are being opened, because we didn't stand a chance in this one. There was planned by, let's just say, the negative ETs and visitors, that there were five other occasions that extinctions were launched on this planet. They were before the humans were on it. This was going to be the sixth extinction, and it was scheduled for 2012. And because of what the Guardians are doing, that is not going to happen. We're not fighting with anyone. We're standing. We're standing in the frequency as the Christ, and we were being taught Masters Templar mechanics to be able to assist them or the ground crew, just like on the other side you have what we call the Metatronic crew that are working the Atlantean Death Star, Merkaba stuff that is what runs the wormholes. There's a whole bunch of people running around thinking they're doing ascension
yes.
that aren't. And
exactly.
that is what is heartbreaking.
Yes.
When I started to go public with the Guardian teachings, like, oh, great, you know, it's going to be great in the New Age movement, and everybody, yeah, we're going to love each other. Oh, my God. I ended up like the black sheep in the New Age movement. Why? Because we exposed the teachings of Toth. Not any of the people here. We exposed the records. Toth broke the Emerald Covenant way back in the Atlantean period. He stole one of the CDD plates, took the knowledge from it, and created the Emerald Tablets of Toth, which had a bunch of mechanics that were the Death Star mechanics. He helped in the takeover. And he still is.
Yeah. Okay.
Because that being is still in existence. He pops back and forth. Yeah. He can travel through time in his little Death Star Merkaba. But it wasn't just Toth. There's a whole bunch of them. So when it was pretty heartbreaking as this information, because I was thinking, oh, great, we're all going to love each other, and you know, yeah, it was ascension time. Yeah, right. It didn't work that way, because nobody wanted to hear it, and it's too bad. At least there were some people that wanted to hear it, because they came to workshops. Mm-hmm. And the thing is, we asked the people that were teaching the other stuff nicely. So why don't we just have a public discussion about it? You know, seriously, we'll each put up half of a room cost and, you know, invite free to the public. Mm-hmm. And just let's discuss the topics, the issues. They wouldn't, but what they started to do was blackball me behind my back at the workshops, tell people to be afraid of me, tell them, oh, you'll die if you use your Merkaba that way. We have more Merkaba mechanics than they could dream about. I mean, they couldn't touch the stuff with a 10-foot pole. That's why they wouldn't even take on the challenge of, come, let's talk about it. Mm-hmm. Let's talk about the history. That's, you know, that you can say, well, it's this or that, but these mechanics are indisputable because they don't have the things that link them together. The Guardians showed us all of these different things, sacred geometry, how it fit, not just, oh, here it's a this. What is a that? What does it mean? How does it connect to the cosmos? They showed cosmic structure in order to show how it's supposed to work, and then they showed where the distortions they're teaching fit and what they do to pervert it. So it's been very intense since we came out with the work, and it hasn't changed. But there's a group of us that just resonate with this and go, wow. Yeah, just, wow, okay, no problem, you know? Like,
yeah, well, that's one of the reasons I'm here. And, you know, I'm aware of the distortions out there. I'm aware of the attacks and so on and so forth. And, again, I have to say that people need to really go into their hearts. They need to use their heart and their intelligence to discern what resonates. And we're presenting this as what resonates, I'm going to say personally, with me, but also with what I think people need to be aware of, and then they make their own decision. We've got plenty of the other side of information out there, and I think it's time that we hear from this side. And so, you know, I really want to thank you for making this opportunity possible. I do want to say that there are a lot of people out there that are following the wrong path, And if there's a way that you can also talk about the distinctions so that they can be aware, like if you get this, you might want to question more the path you're on. In other words, certain things will come to the fore during meditation. Mm-hmm. Certain things will come to the fore even in their everyday life where they're getting a lot of interference on certain levels and so on and so forth that can indicate that they are being tapped into by service to self ETs. Mm-hmm. And if you have that and you want to sort of share that, we don't have to do it now because that would be maybe off the topic a little bit here, but later on.
I think we'll probably come in that if we can move a bit with the sequence. The reason why the Guardians gave this sequence was because it's an easy way to touch a whole bunch of the bases, give a rounded picture that go right into, you know, answering the questions that you wanted answered.
Okay.
So if you want to go off the sequence, it's okay, but I
no,
think...
No, let's go with this. And also, just one other thing that you're saying, we got this information and you're talking about yourself. Are you talking about other members of your group also getting this information?
Some of us do.
Okay.
Yeah, we all have a kind of special relationship, our own special relationship. I have the translator's contract, which means I'm the secretary, right? I take down the writing. But even like the other speakers have a rapport also with the Guardians, and a number of people in the groups have developed a rapport with them as well. In fact, we work with them to help them to do that. That's what the Guardians would like, is to, you know, start communicating where they can start teaching people directly, because we're like a little bottleneck on the information. You know, it's only given through the workshops and that kind of thing. Yeah. So I talk about it as we, not that I'm a plural, but that there's a bunch of people that are interacting with the Guardians directly. I'll just go really quick on these then, because there's another point I want to get to that we can pop through these, but I want to bring something up that's very important. As far as telling the difference between some of the teachings too, this in general is just showing basic Stargate structure, like how they work. When you have the core gates we saw before, these are what happen when you have those other flows that happen, the lotus petal flows. When you have a Stargate area, you have two vortices of energy, one electrical, one magnetic, and when they activate in the center, they come together, and one goes down, one goes up, and they form what's called a Biveka Merkaba field. All right, and that Merkaba field is, what does it mean? Moving light body, Merkaba, right? The Merkaba field is the field that actually, if it's around you, if it's a natural one that occurs around you, it's also occurring within you, and that is what allows your atoms to bond with their antiparticle and transmute and transfigure so they can go through gates. So this is basic Stargate structure as far as the Amenti gates were structured on this structure and those kind of things. There's more to that. There's the Merkaba part. All right, there's the two vortices, right? And this is when they come together to form a Merkaba field. Now, this is a Merkaba field that's just done with vortices. These get more specific where they have fins, where they're actually like three-sided pyramids that move through each other. But I just wanted to see the basic structure of when Stargates activate these Merkaba fields, which are vortice fields, activate within them and also within your body and around your atoms and in your atoms. This thing here is something that I would like to point out. This is called a Kathara grid. Light sound one, Kathara. It is literally the radiation template upon which everything in the eternal life systems are structured. It is the first creation template, and it has very, very specific proportions. Some people say, oh, it's a tree of life, but actually if you look at it, it isn't. It's actually the tree of eternal life. When you see something that is different than this, say it has maybe 10 of these centers instead of 12, right? This has 12. Or maybe it's longer and skinnier, or it doesn't have the lines in the same way. Mm-hmm. What that is a twisted radiation creation template. And it's passed off as a tree of life, in certain teachings. It's actually the tree of artificial life. It goes with what's called the Death Star, Atlantean Merkaba mechanics, the Metatronic mechanics. This is the natural structure of what is called a Kathara grid. And in a minute you see how important this is, because literally the structure of the cosmos, of Stargates, but all of those structures we saw a little bit of with the circles, the spheres, right? Wherever you see a sphere, it implies we call these the bones. You have the bones and the balls. The bones are the radiation template that is built on Kathara grid. And Kathara grid will always have these proportions. They're very specific proportions in relation to each other. And that is a living template, And with that template and the structures built upon it, we'll be living. Our body structures, we have one that runs through our body that right now is very mutated because of the planet, and we'll see that, a little bit of that later. But we are moving to reactivate the natural imprint. So the cathara grid I wanted you to see because it will help you understand the maps. You're going to understand stargates and wonder where, okay, if I ascend, where am I going? Right? Seriously, like if you're going to leave, where are you going? Do you even have a clue as to where what the choices are? They've shown us where these maps go. This is the beginning of understanding maps. I'll just show you this really quick, because this is showing, there's a sheet that talks about, I'm not going to talk about all the proportions right now, because it's heavy detail, but this sheet explains about how this actually controls how particles interact with each other, and all sorts of things, from angular rotation to particle spin of particles in universes and that kind of thing. So this is just showing this specific proportions that is very important. So when you see something using as a sacred geometry, this structure that is not built on those proportions, it is actually representative of one of the other teachings that is teaching distorted template mechanics that have to do with wormholes and black holes.
Interesting.
Yeah. The more of this came out, the more horrified I was. I really was. I was like, oh my God, Lois, please, you know, I don't want to have to talk about this, right? It was very hard. Now at this point, I have to have a sense of humor about it. You know, where it's, okay, so I am the pariah of the New Age movement, whatever. Somebody has got to let people know about this. That's why I still do, because it makes more sense than the other stuff that's being taught. And there's so much love in these teachings and in caring about people enough. Like, okay, so you might be mad at me because you liked that paradigm over there, and I just kind of don't mean to be a whistleblower, but if you're hurting yourself with that Merkaba, maybe you should not do that, you know? Anyway, go back on this. Sorry. This is showing simply, remember that little cathara grid structure, right? Well, here's one, here's another. These cluster. All right, these are radiation templates that cluster to form very complex structures. This particular structure we call the Stairway to Heaven. All right, one of these cathara grid structures would hold four density levels of our local universe. All right, let's say the Milky Way galaxy, but there's actually more to it than the Milky Way. So that would be like our local universe. It actually includes Milky Way and Andromeda M31 galaxy. All right, and it's connected to another one. The one at this angle, 90 degrees to it, would be considered as parallel. It also has a light field that goes with it. So these are intricate structures that are formed from these templates. And where you see these structures, these are the bones again, you will have spheres of energy and spheres within spheres built upon them. So there are various levels. These are called the Veka systems, and four Vekas come together, and at the center an Eka system forms. And the Eka systems form a cluster, and they form what's called an Akasha system. Then there's an Akasha A system and Akasha Aya system, and they all form this big cluster that's called the Ukhtarishta body. The Ukhtarishta body is one cosmic creation body. Now, our own personal anatomy has these levels to it. All right, they connect to those levels of the cosmos that we were born into. And full ascension is actually turning back on in our atomic structure all of the frequencies involved with all of those spaces. So we're down here in the Veka worlds. The next thing is we have to move up into the Eka, and then from the Eka, this is the long way to ascend, by the way. That's when the gates are working well. So the normal way for ascension would be you would work your way through re-evolution through the Veka system up the densities. We were in density 1 here, we'd work up to density 4, then we'd go to the Eka level, and you're growing and getting lighter, and your matter's less dense, and you're getting more control over it, and you're getting more consciousness, you know, more God consciousness and that kind of thing. And then you would work to the Akasha level, and then you would work to the Akasha A level, and then the Akasha A level until you got up here. At any one of those points, you could experience the Christ star turnaround, and it would take you to the next level, right? Then there's the quick way to ascend when it's an evac, when it's an evac situation, and that's what we have, where these are called harmonic gate systems. It implies that it's built on a system of dimensional harmonics, which means you have to take them in sequence harmonically, one by one. It's the slow train, right? There's something called the transharmonic continuum. It actually runs between them. It requires a very specialized type of Merkaba vehicle and accelerations in the light body and spirit body anatomy to be able to do it. But those core gates, which are also the Navajo gates, they're also called the spanner gates, they are able to do that. They are transharmonic, where they can actually jump the scale. So you can jump from here to here, or from here, you know, to there. So you can move, you have more liberty of where you can go in ascension when you ascend. You're able to actually, you become a time jumper, basically, instead of just a straight, you know, ascension the hard way. You know, you go boing, 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 that kind of thing. So that is the system we're working on, because at this point, all of the natural structures of the outer gates have been damaged. The Amenti gates are damaged. We are stuck down here. And the same thing is happening through the Milky Way. It's not just here. It's not just in our solar system. Our solar system is a mess, but the Milky Way is a mess too. That black hole at the center, that's not an accident. That was done on purpose. That was done 360 billion years ago. We actually used to, Milky Way actually used to be a part of the Andromeda Galaxy. And it was literally forced into what is called fall. And now there's many light years between them, at least a couple. I forget how many light years were between them, 2 million light years, something like that. But they were once one. That is actually our home galaxy, the Andromeda M31. But right now we're in the Milky Way, which is a fallen random part of it. And there's still, it wasn't a full fall system until recently, when certain changes occurred that mean the quantum of energy going into the negative fall path is larger than the one pulling back the other way. And at that point, there is it's a galactic evac where they're pulling out the ones who can still go. You know, the consciousness that can still follow the ascension path is being evacuated out, because the gates will close. Once they close and the system falls, that system won't immediately blow up or anything. It will have a finite lifespan. It no longer has the direct currents coming in, the inflow of currents coming in from the larger structure of space-time and source. So it becomes a finite system that feeds on itself until it eats up its own quantum, and then it implodes and goes back as space dust. So we are at a crossroads, a huge crossroads right now. We are on a planet that is going in the fall direction, but this planet's actually going to take that path I'd mentioned, the step back path, but that requires losing its body, and it's going to do that. Not while we're on it, but that is what we're headed for. But right now we have 200 years to before these gates close in the Milky Way galaxy, and that includes here. So this is why they're giving the advanced ascension teachings now. And this is why crazy people like me come out and talk about them with the vocabulary, because we could use a dictionary, honestly.
No, I mean, you know, I expect people, it's good if they go, what did she talk about there? I don't get it, or go investigate, you see. Right. We're not here to answer all their questions, actually.
Okay, well, I don't mind.
Investigation is getting involved. Right. And if they get involved, they learn, and then it becomes part of them.
Well, so when we see the structures, when I'm showing things like the structures, these are structures that are not known out here yet. They have words that describe them. You know, they have names for that structure. That's a Hara body, or that's a Yukatharista body, mm-hmm. right? You know, or that's a Veka, and that's an Eka. These are part of the actual templates of the layers of creation going all the way back up into expansion into God's source consciousness field. They are the literal bones of our space-time orientation. So they are time references. When I talk about a Veka system, that is down here, closer to where we are in a Veka system, right? When you get up to the next level of ascension, there is the Eka system, which is at the core of four Vekas. Then you get up from there and you have what's called an Akasha system, which has a set of all the smaller ones inside of it, right? And then an Akasha A system, and then you go up into the Yukatharista system, which is really, they are words to describe things that make perfect sense, you know, to the people who are describing them, the guardians. Sure. They're words in the ancient what's called Anahazi language, which was the first spoken language in this time matrix. So a lot of the language that is used, you know, that it's like, what is that? It's translations from those languages.
Okay, does Anahazi relate to Anasazi?
Actually, it does. Okay. The Anasazi were connected to the guardians, actually.
So did they ascend? Is that why they disappeared?
Some of them did. Others, they were actually raided, from what I heard. They were raided and overtaken by another group, mm-hmm. and some of that other group became Anasazis as well, where they became violent, and the original ones weren't like that, and yes, some of them were evac'd locally, is what I heard.
Okay. The Kabbalah is gotta be, I mean, you know, I'm gonna just say it here, to my understanding from what you're telling me, is that Kabbalah is not the positive ascension path.
I would put this way, in relation to the Kabbalah, or the Bible, mm-hmm. or the Koran, or any of the texts that are out there. There are elements of truth, all of which came from the original teachings that were on this planet. There were 12 legions of the Christ, 12 bodies of teachings that went with the CDD plates. there are pieces of those that have wound up in the religions of today, and there are distortions in all of them as well, which means they all carry a mixed path.
Okay.
And the way to tell, it takes a while to develop the sensitivity, but there is something inside and visible of everything, be it a cup or a cosmos or a set of letters written on a page. There's something called an encryption. An encryption is a very specific radiation signature that is underlying. It's in the dark matter template. When you get to a certain point in DNA activations, which sensitize your inner senses in your body, you can know with direct cognition. You can read a sentence and know which part is taking you in which direction. Mm-hmm. So anything, like the Kabbalah, there are some beautiful things in the Kabbalah. And they also use a mutated tree of life because they don't remember any different. And they were tricked. Just like there's a lot of great things in the Christian religion that are, you know, true to form, and a lot that aren't. Mm-hmm. There's been trickery ever since the Atlantean periods here. Well, there was before too, but that was the big showdown for trickery. And what we have now are the trickle-down ideas and piecemeal memory and piecemeal history of what could be salvaged from that time. There's a reason we don't remember. We'll get into that a little bit when we get into that stuff I talked about at the end that was important. But our stance isn't to make any of the other paths wrong. There's only one that we actually will stand against. If they're directly teaching Metatronic Death Star Merkaba, we have to address that. We don't address the people who are teaching it. We feel bad for the people who get caught up in that. I feel bad for anybody who's contacted by Toth. Because, well, I've known Toth in other lives, and I've known Toth in this life. And he's, you know, he once upon a time was a speaker. You know, an Emerald Covenant speaker. And he broke the Emerald Covenant, and he decided to go with the Anunnaki races and go into a fall path and stole the technologies. And part of what he did is why this planet is going in the path it is now. So it isn't the people that, you know, we don't blame the teachers of those things or the people listening to channels and they don't know what the heck they're listening to. I mean, oh, right, you know, it's cute and it's fun and it's lovely. And yeah, right, check its resume. But how do you? You know, we're any of the religions, any of the New Age or the Old Age religions, there's good and there's not good in both of them. And it's almost like you need to feel out and feel what works right for you. But don't limit yourself to just saying, oh, well, it has to be the Jehovah God, or it has to be the Allah God, or it has to be the this God, or that God. You can call God whatever you want, but, you know, God doesn't really need you to call it anything. It is beyond gender qualification. We were created in the image of God, all of us. And that doesn't mean we are all male or all female. It means we are all living consciousness fields that have the potential of direct creation and eternal life. And that is what that line meant. So the Kabbalah is fine, certain parts aren't. Same applies to every paradigm that is, you know, traditionally on the planet and a lot coming in from the New Age, except for the Death Star mechanics. They're very direct, you know, not sacred geometry. So if that answers that question.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay,
thank
good.
You.
Alrighty, where are we? Back to this. I just wanted to show this again quickly. This again is the diagrams we've used to show the structure of the spirit body with its flows and its core flows, and that's also the gate structures and all of that. It means that the cosmos has sets of spirit bodies. There's like lots of these embedded within each other, and we also have our spirit body. When I refer to our spirit body as part of our anatomy, it is structured in this same way. Okay? We'll see in the next one how that fits in with, remember the Stairway to Heaven and the Ekatharista body? Right? Those structures are actually part of what's called the light body anatomy, be it on the cosmic level or the personal level. This is how they fit together. This is that Ekatharista thing with all those little interwoven cathara grids, right? And this is the basic structure of spheres within spheres from the spirit body, the cosmic spirit body, that all of those exist within. Every one of those little cathara grids would have a set of these, right? These become the spirit body, the 12 spheres in the spirit body that, remember, go in sets across a vector line, right? And at certain points, they actually pull in to the center, and that's how, at a certain point of expansion, you contract back into the center and go back into God's source. These are actually, this is how the Adashi adepts, the ones who have achieved ascension, actually use these structures as maps. These are literal maps of how they judge. If you are here and you want to go to Cirrus B density 2, right, These are the maps they use to get there. They are the gate interface maps. We can locate ourselves on these maps. There's one that shows exactly where we are in the Milky Way galaxy, because we're actually M31 galaxy, but we're a part that's twisted off but still connected to it energetically. We can show our location. We can also show the locations where the black hole systems are that are interfacing here, that are messing with us now, and where the main guardian groups are coming from and where they're helping us. So these are literally maps. These maps then translate into, these are all probability fields. So you might have one, say, galaxy, and it's 12 different probable expressions. And they all of these are spinning, right? And they interface with each other all of the time. So they're like bubbles within bubbles that don't collide and collapse each other. Well, they're not supposed to. If they're doing the Death Star mechanics, they actually do. But there's a natural system of probabilities. So it's not just we have a parallel universe, right? We have many parallel systems and adjacent systems and neighboring systems. And so this is literally the structure of the maps of the cosmos. These are the structures you use. Once, say, you get to the point where you can ascend, well, you have to first of all decide where you want to go, and then where is the map to get there? These are the maps. So I wanted to show you how those structures that are on a small level, our own multidimensional anatomy is structured that way. But on the large level, this is the structure of the maps of the cosmos. There is a structure that science does not know about yet. They have no idea how complex it is. Each one of these structures, they've taken it from the first little, they call it a particle unit, the first unit of consciousness, how that structure grew each stage, right? So we have like hundreds of diagrams that go with these to show how the Gathar grids all filled out, to show how these structures of the spirit body and all their flows filled out. Inside of the spirit body flows, which isn't on this one, you'll actually find where what is called the Hall of Records exists, what it is, the Akashic Record, all of that thing. It's part of this anatomy structure. The planet has one, the solar system has one, the galaxy has one, etc. So these are not just interesting little diagrams on a paper. These are very practical. They're just as practical as a map you'd buy down at the gas station to get, you know, somewhere horizontally.
Next one, okay, please. And isn't it true that we also have 12 incarnational bodies that have incarnated simultaneously that mirror the same pattern there?
1728.
Okay.
Simultaneous. Your existence implies the 1727 others.
Okay.
But are you
okay,
different
but there
forms?
There is something to do with the 12.
Yes, there's sets of 12.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, you have your first 12, then you have, well, it basically has to do with the density levels. We're in density 1 down here. Density 2, you have your incarnate identity here. You would have a set of 12 incarnates. And if you put those 12 back up to density 2, you would have one soul, mm-hmm. right? That is your soul, your density 2 level of identity. Now, that one soul would be a group of, 11 others. It's part of a set of 12.
Sure.
And you pull all those together, come up to density 3, and that's where you are an oversoul. Mm-hmm. And that oversoul is a part of a group of 12 oversouls. That you pull it up to density 4 is an avatar. And then you have a group of 12 avatars, pull it up to density 5, and then you would have your Rishi identity, which is your fully formed Vekka level identity, to come into the densities down here. But there's other levels of identity that go up beyond the 15-dimensional system. Those 5 densities that I just talked about each have 3 dimensions, so there's your 15-dimensional stack right there in one time system. So does that help?
Yes,
yes,
that's
and
12s.
12s,
yes.
Many 12s. This is just a real quick glimpse to show that these time cycles that we've talked about in relation to these structures, they are quite specific. These were given as far as time frames. One time vector here on this planet, and they're using translations into Earth time, as we know Earth time. One time vector is 738 years. One time continuum is 4,426 years. One Uego is 26,556 years. A Uego time cycle is a Stargate cycle. That is when the Stargates on the planet open, once every that period, right? Right now it's distorted into what are called the false Yuga cycles, and we'll show you what that is at the end. But these go all the way up. There's galactic levels, there's universal levels, and these are the structure of time and how it works, and that, yes, you can take it right into, you know, periods of time. It is because we are in a stellar activation cycle right now, and the last one was 26,556 years ago, and it failed. The gates did not open. They had to be shut closed because we got raided. That was called the Iani Massacre period, where there was a lot of ships mowing people down, actually, in that one.
Okay.
Beam ships.
And was this, we're not talking about Atlantis here, we're talking prior?
There were several phases of Atlantis.
Okay.
All right, the last phase of it, the last pieces of it went under in 9558 BC. But way before that, there was Atlantis. There was in seeding one, there was an Atlantis. In seeding two, there was an Atlantis. And on Terra, there was an Atlantis. That's where it all came from. And a Lumeria. We had Lumeria, Lumania. There were different spellings of the names, but they were the same places and the same soul groups inhabiting them.
Yeah.
So this was like the 9558 BC period, the last period, that was like the late Atlantean period.
Okay.
So there was a lot of Atlantis period anyway. But these stargate cycles, this is the cycle that our gates open on, this planet's gates are supposed to open on, the 26,556-year cycle. It's now been shortened because of what they're doing to the planetary grids and the stargates and the Templar to what's called the false Yuga cycles, which is plugged into the precessions of the equinox, which is not natural. And we'll look at what that is about and when that started, because that really, really came into fore about 13,000 years ago. When a major victory on, and this was an Atlantean drama, a major victory on, just let's say, the dark agenda side had occurred. They created something called the Toral Rift. It is a time rip. And it was, they literally plugged Earth's Templar into this time rift and knew that when it came to the next stellar activation cycle, they would use it to draw Earth in. It's not just Earth they're after. Earth connects still to its corresponding planet or star, actually, in M31 that is called Urtha. There is still a direct energetic link between the gates. They're after M31 as well. So it's a much bigger drama than people here realize. They're not just after little Earth. Earth has always been a fighting place because of its connection to the larger universe and because it was connected as part of what was called the Crystal River Host. That was when, a long, long time ago, 360 billion years ago, when the Milky Way fell out of M31, there was a whole collective of guardian beings from various other, I hate the word ascended just because of the way it's misused down here, of the Adashi Adepts, people who formed a coalition to assist in trying to re-evolve the Milky Way back into its natural position so it could continue as an ascension system. So, excuse me, I'm getting interrupted. They want me to go somewhere else. Okay, I don't know. Sometimes it'll happen. I'll let you see that. I don't have to let you see that, but I did. All right, they're saying go somewhere else for now. We'll come back to that. Okay, anyway. So they don't want me to talk about galactic history yet. Okay. Yeah, I get that sometimes, even when I'm on stage.
Okay,
where I'll
yes.
just get a like, little, hello.
Okay. Why are you saying, what is their motivation? And if you want to put this question off till later, we can do that. But what you're saying, they were after Earth. They were after Earth, and they were after it because of its connection with the larger universe. So why? What is their motivation for taking us down, for
what
closing
core,
it off and making it a finite
objective?
System?
Right. What is the core objective? Food. They're in a black hole system that has fallen. They're, because of the nature of the physics dynamics involved with creation, the way eternal life creation works, is when a thing falls, it loses its connection to the inflow and backflow of energy from the source consciousness field, which means it gets left with only the quantum it had when it fell. Mm-hmm. Now, everything is spinning. That takes energy. It uses up its energy, and if it doesn't suction energy off something else, it will implode and go back to space dust return, which is what a system was meant to do, so everybody, nobody gets stuck and everybody gets to go home, either as space dust or, hole through ascension, whichever, at least to go home. These groups that have adopted the false creation, they've tried to recreate the creation because they didn't like the consequence their own choices brought to them in relation to the physics reactions to the actions they took. They ended up in a false system and they wouldn't face the reality that, you can make peace with that. Even if you're in a false system, you can say, well, that was pretty dumb to get ourselves into that, but we're here and we can handle ourselves with grace. We can still love creation. We can still act in loving ways. They decided instead it would be more interesting to keep themselves alive by using a vampire technology. They're going after it for quantum food to feed their system. If they can harness this system, literally the entire quantum of energy that is in this system will be drawn into their black hole system, which will give their whole system more life. So they're postponing the inevitable But they keep using these technologies to do that, and they prey on living systems. But there is a point in time where that backfires, and they're getting very close to that point too. So anyway, that is the core motivation. Okay. It's not that anybody's mad at anybody else, or they're fighting over this toy or that toy. This is big. They're fighting over survival, and they feel that they have to kill the living systems in order to have that energy as food, period. And that becomes the most important obsession for them. And it is a twisted thinking. When a being gets that far into de-evolution, where it really has no remorse, they don't have what you'd call emotional bodies like we do anymore. They don't care. They just take. Mm-hmm. And they don't care about giving. They don't think about that. And they don't want to hear it. You can't rationalize with a certain level of fall consciousness. So that is what we're dealing with. And that is why it is a very large story. But it's really not very personal story. You know, it's like, don't take it personally. Do you take it personally if you're swimming and a shark rips off your leg? Mm-hmm. It's a shark.
Sure.
You had a leg. It swam by. I mean, are you going to hate the shark? It's just doing what its instinct moves it to do. And that's kind of like what is happening here. So if that's how I've been taught to look at it. And I'm at peace with it. I don't like it, but I'm at peace with it in that regard. But I will stand for the things that, for me, that mean the most to me. And I believe in the loving creator God source field, and I believe in being fair to people, and I believe in telling the truth even if it's hard, and I believe in facing the truth even if you'd rather pretend it wasn't there, and dealing with it and taking it forward from there. So anyway, those consciousness don't think like that, but that's what it means for me when I say, you know, we stand in the Christ. That's what it means. It's not fighting with these beings. You know, I mean, you can do that, but they're just engage in your energy anyway. But we do have to stand and work the gates here. Somebody has got to take care of the remaining gate potentials here so the consciousness can evacuate out within the next 200 years that is going on the upward swing. So, that good enough?
Okay, yeah. Very good.
Tangents. So this is just showing the time, like there are literal translations into Earth time. And this would apply, like you could go sit on Venus or something, and then you could translate them into Venus time, which would be different because time has to do with how fast things spin and all of that. And like, never mind. The physics of how long your day is and your sidereal time and all that crazy stuff that I don't like. With all the structures and processes that we've learned that have to do with that structure of the spirit body and its hara centers, which are the probability structures that at certain periods pull in, right? And that's an ascension cycle when they actually pull in and then a new creation comes back out. There are ways to track those cycles. There are ways to track from the point of conception onward how your body grows in cycles. And there are also ways to track an evacuation cycle. And they all can use this diagram. This diagram has to do with octants and specific ways the energy is divided up and within those structures that we've looked at. And this is just showing, it's called the loadout schedule from 2008 to 333 AD cycle. Now, it doesn't mean we get the gates are going to be open here until 333 AD. They're going to close over here in 2230. That is when the gate systems here close. But this is actually showing that, okay, once you get through here, there's certain stages. We made it through what was called the Kalihara celebration. We called it a celebration at the time. After certain things happened in 2007, as we moved into 2008, if we did not hit on this planet a certain level of core vibration, we would have gone into fall right there. We would not have been able to hold a host. All the gates would have shut except the fall gates, and we would have all been stuck, and it would have, well, we'd all been extinct in 2012. That was the other side's plan. But we did make the vibration for the Kalihara, which allowed us to pick up into the host, which is called the Crystal River Host. This has to do with a stream of energy currents that are coming in from a matrix that I'll show you later on the maps that are the high level of the Guardian Alliance. They're like the ones that wrote the books originally. They're like the small layers from our matrix. These are massive Mashayanic beings. And that means they're the eternal life beings, the ones who have gone through the Adashi return cycles and, so they're... Anyway, we were able to pick up the host, the planet was, where it could anchor those frequencies as long as there was somebody here to anchor it, and that is what our groups have been doing. We are, our bodies are energy, everybody's bodies are energy, and we're all anchoring something. And right now, the planet, most of it is anchoring the Metatronic currents. And there's a few people that just because they happen to have the DNA codes that they are connected with the Christ and don't know it, are just, going about their little lives, but anchoring it, the good currents anyway. But there are, I'm I'm not aware of any other groups that are working at all with acoustic energies as far as the grid works they're doing. So we go around and we do grid work, and you know, very specific grid work. You know, you see these type of diagrams? Well, when we go to do like grid work someplace, we know what a vortice is, right? We know where to go. We know this information. We don't just go, you know, play like a planetary guardian like a lot of people do, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. People that are inadvertently anchoring the negative currents and opening gate sites on the, you know, the wormhole codes because they don't know, because nobody taught them, you know, the difference between them. So anyway, we made this into this cycle, and this is good, because if we didn't, it would have been all over in 2012. But this, we passed the Kalihara cycle. We're in this cycle period right here, right now, which we haven't come to the center point yet. That'll be 2027 when we hit this point in the cycle. There are certain energy changes that take place here, certain accretion cycles. Now, that means energy coming in cycles, right? These are accretion cycles where energy pulls in to a certain point. There are certain things that happen in each of these stages. So we are right here in this stage. This is the first stage of the what's called the Kali Krista cycle. This is what they call this one, the Barda phase. And then over here, there's the Masha phase, I believe, and that's where you get the Mashayahana word from. And the word Messiah was twisted from that word, the Mashayahana word, in the ancient Atlantean teachings. That's an Anahazi word having to do with, you know,
okay,
this cycle.
And it's related, is it related somewhat to Mahayana? Mahabharata?
Yes. Yes. Very much. In fact, a lot of the Mahabharata texts were some of the remnants that had come up from the Mahabharata texts that, you know, were the translations of the CDD plates much earlier. Yeah. So anyway, we have to this point, when we get over here, that is 2047. I don't have it marked on this one, but this would be the point in this cycle. It would be 2047. And this is where something called an infold happens, where when we go back to remembering the vector line with the Hara bodies on it, right? And at certain points they pull into the center and then come back out again. That is going to occur with the energy systems literally in the parts of this galaxy that can hold the host, including Earth, including our own fields. So right now we're making it through this part of the cycle. There are certain changes that will happen here. This is a point, that middle point, during which something called the Bardo chambers open. Now, the Bardo chambers, it can be a pleasant thing, or it can be a time when people evac the quickest way possible, and we are still looking at the potentiality of there could be major Earth changes that occur during this period.
And at this point,
it's like if we get that far, because what's happening between now and 2012 is pretty rough, and what some of the other ones, like those who make wings, have planned for 2019 isn't too pretty either. So we're trying to help keep the grid stable and the consciousness stable just by working energy, you know, as opposed to trying to go out and preach on anything. You know, we teach what we teach. But there are some, this is a really bumpy period we're going through here because of what the Service to Self ones are doing. And they are seriously just trying to use this. They're trying to take our planet, forget about us, they don't care, they were planning to exterminate us in 2012, and just use it as torque to drag a whole larger system in to feed their black hole. So when you have an objective like that, you really don't care. They don't care how many people are lost, but the Guardians do, and that's why we're still here. So we're moving through this period now. We're probably somewhere right about here, because this will be 2027. There's some rough spots coming in 2019 and 2022. And also, we are in the middle, well, not quite the middle, but in March of, I think it was March 25th, 2007, there were certain things that a particular group of the Raider races called the Borgia, that are connected with the Thetans, they kind of work together, they're on the negative side. They're part of the groups that are fighting over who's going to control this beast machine, this Death Star Merkaba here. They did something with the solar gates at the core of the sun, and they forced closed what is called the prana seed. Now, the prana seed has to do with sophisticated anatomy. We all have one, and so do planets and galaxies. When a prana seed closes, it forces the Bardo, and which means it forces this beginning of the death cycle. And our sun is dying as of that point. That doesn't mean it's immediately going to die. There are 15 layers of the dark matter template called the Rasha body that need to separate from the physical matter body. That will be done in 2022. Now, there is a gamma burst that is released, and right now it's being buffered every time one of those, they call them ring waves, solar ring waves, releases. And they will get stronger as it goes into the higher levels of the rings, the higher numbers of those 15. And 15 comes in 2022. So, so far, so good. We haven't had any major gamma bursts, that, you know, solar flares that wiped everything out. But these are other potentials that we are looking at as well. Okay. As well as earthquakes and, you know, the usual stuff that end times dramas bring. Gosh. But it's not as bad as a lot of the things that some of the other people are teaching. I've heard certain people say that, oh, well, we won't even be here by 2013. Yeah, that's one of the Death Star people.
Right.
Okay. So I'd love to have a public debate about that one, Mr. So-and-so.
Yeah, it would be great to do that.
We invited that person. I think who I'm referring to.
Yes.
Yeah, years ago.
I see.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Mm. So anyway, this is showing the cycle. There are certain different things that happen in this amazing structure of the planetary, solar, galactic, and universal spirit body and light body structures. It's a very specific process that is involved with Christ Star evolution, which is going into that where you fulfill the, where you fulfill meaning accrete or bring in all of the frequencies in the template that you needed to make that Adashi turnaround where you can immortalize your atoms and go into the eternal life, you know, going back cycles. And planets and solar systems and galaxies can do that too. So there's a portion of this system, this galaxy system, that can still do that with the extra frequency that is being added by that host system that is called the Aquarian Matrix. And it's actually the Aquarian Matrix is, they have the prototypes of the what the humans here were actually like designed on. The genetic prototypes were from there, even though we weren't directly from the Aquarian system. We were from M31 and from this particular universe, once, you know, the Milky Way once it fell. But they're very close, closely related genetically, you know, to us in that regard. So they're not like, when I talk about the other ones, you don't have to expect, like, you know, very strange looking beings like, you know, octopi. Some very nice ascended ones do look like that, but these look very human like, but much, much larger.
Okay.
Very, very tall. Yeah, anyway. So this is the cycle we're in at the moment. Now, this one's good. This will show a little bit. This is how these, we can start understanding these as maps. Pretty colored one. I'm so glad people cared to take my black and white messes, right, like these, and, you know, do them properly on the computer. This, again, is just showing the bones, or the interwoven Kathara grids, right, of the Ekatharista body, which is like one cosmic body, right? Down here, Aquinas, caution matrix, we're down in here. Aquinas is actually the name of M31. That's the official name as far as the ancient records go and all of that.
Okay.
And we're part, we were the Aquinas, you know, universe. They call it a universal system. And we call it the M31 Andromeda Galaxy, but it's actually the Aquinas universe. Now, we're located down here. Up here is the Aquarian Akasha Matrix, right up here. So we're down here, and they're up in this section. So it's literally showing the relationships, like, you know, okay, one lives over here and one lives in, you know, Pennsylvania, one's in California, that kind of thing. And there's another one, there's a black hole system, a fall system right here that's called the Wieselay system. And what's interesting about this whole creation is falls can happen where part of the spherical structures of that system literally no longer are energetically connected to the grid. They still hang in the grid, but they're cut off from it. They can only happen on the Veka and the Eka levels. A whole Akasha can't fall. Once you get to the Akasha layer, none of those other layers can fall. And it's just a different type of existence where you don't worry about the polarity dramas that end up in falls and things. So, but this shows us where, yeah, we're here. The ones that are helping us here, this is a, they call it a, it's an eternal matrix, that the purpose they choose to stay in incarnation or stay in existence is to kind of play the helpers for any of the other systems that do need, you know, ones to go in, where they live by a let my will be thy will as far as source goes, and they want nothing other than to fulfill what, you know, source's intention is, which is a loving intention and, you know, an assisting intention. So they find their joy in being of service to assisting the evolutions and, you know, in the lower matrices, and they hold this, these frequencies pure. Their systems stay pure enough where they can actually send currents in and help systems or hold them up so they don't fall, and that's what they're doing with our system right now. This little red one right here, that's our parallel, our immediate parallel system on this level. And this one is a black hole system, all right? The parallels have fallen. We have a parallel Earth, and that finally finished falling in 2003. We have a parallel Milky Way that is a mess, and it's called the Alpha system. That was the first black hole. They look at us as the Omega system. They're the beginning. We're the end. They're planning to pull the two systems together using the Death Star Merkaba mechanics. So this is the locations, anyway, of where who's on first. We're here, over here in the Aquinas. That system, the parallel, is running in here. Our buddies that are helping us with the Crystal River host, sending us energy to literally stop. It's kind of like sending big energy arms down to hold us up, because these guys are pulling so much energy out of us, we would have fallen already. This whole galaxy would have. And then up here, there is another system. This system, the WISA system, is connected with this one. They've linked through wormholes to the center of their cores, their Eka cores, and created a structure, a system of wormhole structures. One of them is the Yod-Heh-Vod-Heh wormhole structure. And anything, any channelings and stuff coming from that stuff, it's coming right out of WISA-Lay and that kind of stuff, and it is a false system. So there's the trickery that is going on here is heartbreaking. You know, it
okay,
seriously
can you
is.
Talk at all about the dimensional aspects of this? Because certain of these systems aren't in certain dimensions. No?
Certain of these systems aren't in certain dimensions.
Because in other words, it seems, at least in the what's out there, we're talking about four-dimensional beings being, you know, the negative service to self coming in through.
Talking about 15-dimensional beings being negative, some of them too.
Oh, really? So going up much higher levels than is currently thought.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, because that's interesting. That
you're
saying there's a backup.
Metatron, for example. Metatron is an entity. It was a Rishi entity, 15-dimensional Rishic identity, and that collective fell. But it was still on the Vekka level. All right, when you get up past the Vekka levels, because we have our density levels, they're inside of a Vekka level. Vekkas go in sets of four, and at the center is an Eka. All that stuff is inside of something called an Akasha level. The Akasha level can't fall, but any of the consciousness or the structures below that can.
Okay, and what levels of density then are we going down from there?
Each set of each Vekka, each Cathar grid, let's say, those little structures that you saw, each of those has like four density and implies a fifth density when you cross through the center. Whether you find that Akasha on the lowest densities in the Vekkas or up in the highest in the structures of the Ukhat-Arista body where it can't fall, it's all consistently, there are five densities and 15 dimensions to each set. They have different types of matter. And different density levels of matter. Some are heavier than others and that kind of thing. So, but that part is consistent from the smallest all the way up to the largest. It is just that the fineness or the refinement of the matter type changes as you go up into the ones that can't fall. There is a refinement to the energy and the consciousness there that you don't find in the one, you know, in the lower systems, even the best of the lower systems. So that, I think that's how I would answer your question.
Okay, and if you get the light beings that manifest here, that are really manifesting, in other words, they really are light beings, what level are they coming from?
It depends.
Could be anyone from what level up?
There is an old saying that light can deceive, but sound tells the truth. Sound is the vibration, right?
Okay.
The encryption. Mm-hmm. It's a feel thing. You can have really beautiful light beings that are coming in the form of, that are actually FAs or fallen angelics that are coming to mess with you. You can have really, really ugly ascended ones that are really good. They come from many different levels. We are learning to turn ourselves into light. We are the things that they are teaching us now, we're learning first bilocation, next is translocation, and then eventually you get to do transmigration, but that requires having certain things where you actually aren't trapped by the planetary time cycles anymore. So light beings, where do they come from? Well, they could come from here, You know, they could come from Venus next door. They could come from the highest levels or the lowest levels. There are light beings that come and visit out of the black hole systems, and there are ones that come and visit from the higher levels. So just because it's a light being doesn't mean it's good light.
Okay.
They've made a distinction. They taught us some very interesting mechanics about the difference of light or radiation signatures, mm-hmm. right? There's something called Shalaya living light, and it's a very specific configuration. It is created out of three units that form a light unit, and matter forms actually build out of these, right? Mm-hmm. And there is another type of light that forms through using the natural light, the organic light that comes from first creation, natural creation, organic creation, is the three balls. I don't have one here, but it's like, they call it the tribeca, where it's like three, one ball on top and two small ones. And that is what the structure of the light unit is. It has the ability for those the two little bottom balls to phase in and out like this and spark when they do. So it can generate its own quantum. So it's eternal, right? There's another type of light that it is not organically occurring. It occurs by bending the natural laws of physics and using the various forms of the Death Star Merkaba mechanics. And that is called the Shona light field. And it is a dead light field. And it is made of, they call it the Vesica Pisces configuration, where it is just two light things together like that, right? Two. And they spin and they spark, but they have to attach to something in order to feed, or they're finite and their spin actually burns them out until they collapse and fall apart, which means the matter forms that they're built on collapse and fall apart. So they are finite light. Mm-hmm. And so that is, you know, the light beings. Is it a light being made out of a Shona field, or is it a light being made out of an organic Shalaya field? Same thing with orbs, right?
Yes,
you can have positive
absolutely.
And negative orbs. I've met some very nasty orbs in my day when I was younger. I used to run from them. I was terrified of them because they would turn into Zetas, right? Yeah, the red ones you had to look out for with the Zetas. Yeah, I'm not saying all red orbs are Zetas, but yeah. So there's things that can be used just because it's a phenomena mm-hmm. doesn't mean it's always good or always negative, right?
Sure.
It that's where learning
okay,
the sense encryption
helps. And
that's
very valuable for people to hear.
Yeah. Good. Okay, back to where are we? Oh, let me go through this quicker. Are we here for ancient times? This is showing a close-up of that. These are my hand-drawn ones, right? Which, in certain ways, I can read them better, probably because I drew them. But they're much prettier when they're done on the computer. This is showing that same thing. It just happens to be tilted the way I drew it first, right? That's that same thing that was up the top before. And this is showing right here where our Vesica system is, right here. But this here is pulling it out so you can look at it a little more closely. Instead of just having the natural Pythagorean structure, right, which is the bones that our sphere there would be built on, there's this tilt, right? The bones are here. The natural Pythagorean, that's the Aquinas matrix, which is M31 Andromeda. And this is the Milky Way now. We're still energetically connected through Earth, right, to, if you notice, there's numbers on these little centers. They're called Cathara centers. Through number 3 on the Andromeda, or the M31 grid, and number 3 Earth on this grid, they are connected. That is the link that has been holding the Milky Way connected to Andromeda. And if the host mission was to try to help the Milky Way evolve back into its natural position, because if something gets stuck like that, eventually it'll fall and be off the grids where it will become finite until it burns out as quantum. So there's always rescue missions that try to bring something back. Earth has been a place of, and so was Tara before Earth became Earth down here. There was a star here called Ashalay, and that is actually the host star that the fragments of Tara were put in to begin this solar system down here in Density 1. That's described a bit in Voyagers. But this is showing the offset, where this is the north axis of M31. This is Milky Ways. They're off tilt with each mm-hmm. other. And that actually creates distance in space-time, a couple million light years. Was it 200 million? I forget. I used to know anyway. But so that's just showing in these maps. Now, you can see that just a little bit closer. When you bring it in, just that little part, that shows those misalignments where this was the natural structure, and that's the structure of the M31 Andromeda galaxy's core template, right? And these are the 12 main stargates in that universe, by the way. This is our Milky Way system. And right here on the number 3 gate, that is where they are still connected. right? These others, there's a whole set of these that show the black hole system. It's called the Prociac black hole, and it's a mess. I mean, it's just, you can see the dynamics of how it works, and the energy twists and stuff, but I'm not going into that on this one, you know, in this particular presentation, because it takes forever. But they're just showing the offset. So, and what this translates into is that distance that we're seeing between M31 galaxy and the Milky Way galaxy. But they are one, and that is our home system. And if we are going to ascend out of the Vecca matrices, we have to ascend through there. Anything in this matrix has to go out through where it came in from because of the encryption that you carry. You will carry the encryption of the gates you came out of, so you need to use them to go back, you know, in the Adashi returns. Mm-hmm. So anyway, that's just some of that. Anything more here?